Hey guys, it's McGann, and today we're going to talk more about the movie 9 with the fantastic Phil from AllMonsters GoToSpace.
So firstly, thank you for inviting me back to talk about this wonderful film.
If you haven't heard of AllMonsters GoToSpace yet, I've got a link in the description below. Phil and Danny do an incredible job researching different mythologies and creatures, and they recently did a video on 9 that recaptured my imagination on the topic, so I'm very excited to have Phil with us today to share some of his knowledge and insights on this movie. And I'm not going to have Phil totally recap his theory this time because I want you to go to his channel and watch it. So go do that now. Hit pause. I'll wait. Back now? Great. So this idea of the Stitch Punks being able to spiritually evolve until they can split themselves up in different pieces like the scientists did, it's so interesting, especially when paired with how the film ends. I always found that that movie very much implies that 7 and 9 are going to be lovers eventually, yet they're technically the same person. So for that idea to kind of work out, the continued growth and development between the characters beyond their basic personality types is definitely suggested.
To me, the end of the film also is very representative of the Stitch Punks transitioning from elements of a person's personality to a family unit and possibly the beginnings of a budding society.
Since the Stitch Punks are not organic and they fall more into the magical beings category, if they continue to develop and grow until they're able to split their souls off into different dolls and thereby kind of repopulate the earth and further their existence, do you think they'll have limitations on the number of times that they can split themselves up? If that's not clear, would it be like one Stitch Punk could split themselves up into 9 different dolls and then die? Or could they split themselves up an infinite amount of times as long as they keep gaining spiritual complexity?
So to answer your question, I'd like to refer to the scientist who died shortly after creating 9. I don't actually believe this was because he split his soul too many times, as I do think that his soul would replenish itself over time. To explain this, I'd like to use the visual example I use in my theory, showing what's known as plant striking, which is where a piece of plant is cut and used to grow a new plant independent of its parent. This, of course, causes no harm to the original plant, as it will regenerate. So I think the scientist's body could no longer take the effects of the machine. This also explains why 9 embodies so many characteristics of the other Stitch Punks. For example, the leadership skills of 1, yet the courage and protective nature of 7. As there was a large period between the creation of the other Stitch Punks and 9, meaning that the scientist's soul had already started to regrow. So as long as the Stitch Punks are not subject to a limited lifespan, they should be able to split their souls infinite amounts of times, as long as they give themselves enough time between doing this, so their souls have time to replenish. Interestingly enough, this plant-striking analogy is supported by the film, as it shows plant-striking imagery in the background of some scenes, almost like a clue.
See, that's why I love talking to you guys, because you are just on it. You see these little plants in the background that I haven't even noticed at this stage in my theorizing of the movie 9. And I like that we're kind of on the same page here, because after watching your 9 video, I thought, yeah, I could see them regenerating like forever till the end of time, especially if they don't have any organic contents to slow them down. But now going even farther to the very last few seconds of screen time in the movie where we get the raindrops and there's the little green microbials in it, do you feel like those green specks are symbolic that the dolls are going to continue to evolve, or do the little microbes have a different meaning?
So it's so interesting that you said this, as to me initially, the microbes seem to represent life returning to Earth, and definitely seems to be something that the scientists intended to happen. And this representing the dolls continuing to evolve is not something I'd thought about. But given how much symbology is actually in the film, I think you actually might be onto something here.
Oh wow, it's like we actually co-developed something just here, because I know every time I've seen the rain, it's kind of been like, oh, this means something. I'm not exactly sure what, but it means something very significant. And yeah, who knows, maybe we're onto something we need to look into further later. But while I have you right now, I know you're so good at these kind of details, so I want to ask you while I have your attention, does the number 9 have any kind of significance to the number of times that the soul can be divided up?
So in Chinese numerology, there are 9 forms of the dragon, which represent a whole. The number 9 also represents divine will, but there are many occult references in the film, like Paracelsus, an occult figure who first wrote about the homunculi, a homunculus being a miniature human made from artificial materials, the Stitchpunks being a perfect example of this. The film also shows the all-seeing eye, so I think the occult is where we should look for specific meaning to the number 9. So according to the Book of Numbers, Their Occult Power and Mystic Virtues by W.W. Westcott, the number 9 holds great significance with many Masonic orders. It says there are 9 kings within 9 roses, 9 lights, and 9 locks. In fact, the number 9 is associated with the earth being under evil influences, which could certainly represent the world in the film, whether those evil influences are the machines or the government.
See guys, if you are not watching All Monsters Go to Space, you are missing all kind of fantastic little things like this that most of us never had any clue existed. I did not know there was any such significance to the number 9 with the world being in trouble. I didn't know it had any kind of connection with like homunculi. Anybody who's seen Full Metal Alchemist, that's a big part of that. So maybe that kind of, I don't know, helped some of us process what a homunculi is supposed to be. Of course, I did my first 9 video on the Enneagram system and how that relates to the 9 different dolls. And while most of them do pair up very closely, there's some that it just doesn't work for at all, like number 3 and 4. I think number 4 was like the individualist, and in the movie it's a twin. So yeah, it's not a perfect fit. But I always felt like there had to be something else going on in the background with why they chose 9 specifically, because it's a little bit of a crowded number for a cast and a movie. So yeah, I'm so glad that there is more and deeper connections to it than that, and I hope maybe that's something that you will explore later and I can watch, or maybe I'll dig into it deeper, but probably not. But follow-up numerical question. I personally lean towards the idea that Tim Burton was just sort of trying to make the cast more diversified and interesting, but is there any reason, numerically or otherwise, why 7 would be feminine? Maybe even why that heroic personality type would be a girl? Also, any thoughts why 3 and 4 would be twins when every other number is associated to a different type of personality?
So I definitely think the scientists intended to make 7 feminine, as he put a great deal of effort into creating the Stitchpunks' appearance around the personality aspects he intended to put into them. For example, 6 being artistic and having quills for fingers, whereas 8 being somewhat of a bodyguard to 1, being far bigger and stronger than the others. As for the number 7 being significant, overall, 7 is a holy number and seen as lucky, and this is reflected in some ways, as 7 does tend to turn up and save the other Stitchpunks at the last moment. As for 3 and 4 being twins, I believe this might have been a sub-experiment by the scientist, seeing how many times he could actually split his soul in one sitting.
You know, that is something that I haven't really thought that much into yet, that the dolls, their bodies themselves, are specifically designed to work in certain functions of their personality. So yeah, that's amazing. I love when you come over here. You and Danny, anytime, you guys are awesome. But my last question for you today might be a little bit sensitive, so I want to preface this by saying that I think all theories are great, that they all have their merits, they all have their strong points, and it's kind of like critiquing fan fiction. It's just, you can like every different theory out there, it's just really based on what works for each person individually and what they like or don't like. I mean, even if two theorists contradict each other, you can still enjoy each theory as separate entities. And I know we have different opinions as to why the machine wanted to collect the souls, and on my end, I see it as Pinocchio wanting to save Geppetto kind of thing. And Phil, I know you mentioned that you see it as the scientist wanted the dolls to be fed to Brain so that he would get some insight on humanity. I almost ended up on a similar train of thought, that the dolls were really just soul fodder to go into the machine purposefully. But I really couldn't get over the fact that the scientists left 9 a message, or the fact that the dolls are so horrified to die. And how I see it is that since the scientists did leave a message for 9, why didn't he tell them that their purpose was just to go get eaten up by this machine? I mean, if there were other humans around, I could see the scientists wanting to keep that hush-hush, but we're kind of told that the scientist is the last man standing, and he knows he's about to die. So what's the purpose of holding any of that information back at that point. I don't know if these questions have answers, but I am curious to hear your thoughts if there's maybe anything you can think of as to why the scientist left no clear instructions, yet he seemed to have a very specific goal in mind. I mean, the scientist definitely wanted the Stitch Punks to do something or be something or create something or, you know, do more than they're told, but I just don't understand why he wouldn't tell them. It's almost like writing a will and then not naming any beneficiaries.
So at the moment, this idea of the scientist feeding the Stitch Punks' brain is thus that an idea. And your theory of brain trying to rebuild the scientist has somewhat won me over to your way of thinking. I do think there's also further evidence to suggest that the scientist did reveal some of his plans to the other Stitch Punks, not only because 9 has the instinct to put the amulet into Brain, but 6 seems to have a lot of knowledge about the amulet. But the Stitch Punk I'm most curious about is 1, who, though his job is a leader and to keep the other Stitch Punks safe, is not concerned when other Stitch Punks go missing or get captured, almost as if he accepts that the Stitch Punks will all eventually have to be sacrificed. He also states, when he sacrifices himself to save 9, sometimes 1 must be sacrificed. All these things to me suggest that 1 knows more than he is letting on, and possibly the true nature of the scientist's plan. Also, as we know, the scientist did leave a message for 9. However, this was an impromptu message and recorded shortly before he created him, almost as if the scientist knew he was running out of time. This also might explain why 9 was never actually finished, missing things like a voice box.
That is actually an excellent point, because if that last bomb hit, or whatever it was that took out the last of the humans, and the scientist knew that, you know, it's coming, but I don't have a lot of time to prepare, that might fill in more plot holes than I'd like to admit. I like it to be kind of deeper and see things that are not always so transparent. But those are all the questions I have for you today, Phil, so thank you so much again for being here.
So before I go, I'd just like to thank you again for inviting me back. It's been a great deal of fun, and I'd love to do more collaborations with you in the future.
You are definitely on my future collab speed dial for any time you want to come back. And if you ever need a half-baked opinion on your channel, just send me a message. Okay guys, that's really it. So go look up All Monsters Go to Space if you haven't already. Go subscribe, post comments, have fun. There are so many videos on there that has so many great details and tidbits. You'll lose hours enjoying yourself over there. And hey, if you haven't subscribed to the Fangirl yet, there's a subscribe button below. This is the channel. You love us. You know it. Enjoy us. Have fun with us. We'll see you next time. Bye. Well, that's all I have for now, but this video's not quite over yet. I get a lot of comments that say, do a theory on this topic, but I've already done those theories. So please consider going to my main channel page and clicking on the video tab so that way you can see everything I've done. You will probably find a lot of things you like that you never even knew that I posted. I want to let you know that I also have 2 other channels, Say Halo Goodbye Gaming and the Fanily Family Vlogs. Thank you so much for watching, and I hope you enjoyed enough to hit subscribe and share. I can use all the help I can get to let other people know that this channel exists. And if you made it this far, leave me a comment that says something like, hey, I made it to the end, and then let me know what kind of videos you want to see in the future. I can't make any promises, but the more people that request something, the more I can look into it. Okay, well, I love you. I'll see you in the next video.